الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على النبي الأمي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين يا رب صلي وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. Respected listeners, Allah gave us tawfiq to learn more about the beloveds of Allah Ta'ala, the beloveds of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, those whom through them deen reached us, and their teachings and practices are guidance for us throughout all times, through trying times, challenging times, and times of comfort and ease. In all conditions, Sahaba radiallahu anhum's lives are the perfect example for us, because they are the shining lanterns for humanity. This one Sahabi radiallahu anhu that we are to discuss has many specialities. And one of the specialities of this Sahabi is that he was that Sahabi who actually met Dajjal. And another speciality about him is that he was the first to bring the lanterns and the lamps into Masjid Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's Mubarak Masjid, the mother of all the masajid throughout the dunya, from where deen and hidayat spread to the four corners of the world. That masjid was a simple, beautiful, yes, big masjid, but simple masjid. There was no lantern or lamp in the masjid. This sahabi was the first to initiate that beautiful practice that brought joy to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we learn the speciality of this sahabi. Like we learned previously, one of the specialities of Abdurrahman bin Auf radiallahu anhu was that he was imam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on that occasion performed salah behind him. Besides Abdurrahman was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, towards the latter portion of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, as Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was leaving this world, and Imam Bukhari rahimahullah brings another report that I didn't mention previously, that on one occasion Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to bring unity amongst two communities, and he mentioned to Bilal radiallahu anhu that if I delay in my return, put Abu Bakr forward radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So that was in Medina Munawwar as well. Abdurrahman radiallahu anhu was imam in Tabuk, and Rasulullah ﷺ performed salah behind him. So anyway, discussing these Sahaba radiallahu anhum specialities, this Sahabi, he was the first to bring the lantern into Masjid Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was originally from Palestine. He is none other than Tamim ibn Aws al Dari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So he is Lakhmiyun from the Banu Lakhm tribe, Palestinian, he is from Palestine, Arabiyun, and he was Arab in his upbringing and origin and tribe. Let's remember his name, Tamim ibn Aws, Al-Lakhmiyul Filistiniyul Arabiyu Ad-Dariyu. He was from the Banu Dar tribe, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Yes, all the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were the best of scholars, but he is known to be one of the scholars of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the ulama amongst the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. And so much of wisdom he had, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Another speciality of the Sahabi is, despite coming to meet Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the latter portions of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's worldly life, in that short span he memorized the Quran al-Kareem. So how devoted was he? How devoted was the Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu? And also another speciality, we learn one important lesson. When he went through this amazing ordeal, where he met Dajjal, and Dajjal asked him certain questions, inshallah we will discuss the hadith, that prompted him to actually want to meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We draw one very, very important lesson there. That yes, for a believer, amrul mu'min kulluhu khair. In another wording of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ajaban li amri al-mu'min." Amazing, astonishing is the affair of the mu'min. The mu'min, his condition is amazing. "Ajaban li amri al-mu'min." Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, because whatever situation comes his way is always good for him. Because the believer sees Allah's wisdom in everything, and he's happy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every situation. In asabatuhu sarra, if good conditions come his way, he's appreciative, he's thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is best for him. And if challenges, difficulties afflict him, he knows this is from Allah, and he's still happy with his Allah, he bears these trying conditions patiently, and that is also best for him. So we learn that even in this ordeal that he went through, How difficult is that? That also became some khair for the Sahabi, where he became the Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he comes to Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrating this amazing event. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so happy and quoted his ordeal to the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum. So we learn one very, very important lesson from Tamim ibn Aws radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. What is that lesson? That when the seniors narrate from the juniors, riwayatul akabir anil asagir. Yes, obviously we learn everything from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it comes via Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Here when he narrates this amazing ordeal or journey, Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam approves this and mentions to Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, yes, see, this is what I have been narrating to you about Dajjal. So this we learn that it doesn't mean a person is of advanced age, we stopped learning. We stop learning. We always learn throughout our life. This is our Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam's teachings for us. That's why we have this opportunity where we are facing this ordeal. Let's learn as much as we can. Let us increase in knowledge. Let us improve in our tilawat of the Quran. Let us spend our time correctly. Let us practice as our seniors and our elders are explaining to us. Establish the halaqa of ta'aleem in every home. Make every home like masjid. Morning and evening recite Surah Yasin, our elders are telling us. Daily recite Surah Al-Kahf. Yes, on Friday as we have today, recite Surah Al-Kahf. But daily, actually, Allama Alusi rahimahullah's tafsir, he explains that we encourage to recite Surah Kahf on Friday repeatedly, not only one time. Because the more we would recite this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect us from fitan. More so, ulama are explaining to us, Hazrat Mullah Ibrahim sahab, damal barakah to whom says so beautifully, recite Surah Al-Kahf daily. Hazrat Mullah Shabir sahab said so beautifully, actually also learn the meaning of this chapter, because this is that surah. When we recite, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect us from the fitan of Dajjal. And also, what will protect us from the fitan of Dajjal is the qualities that are explained in this beautiful chapter of the Quran Kareem. Those qualities Allah ta'ala wants us to inculcate and imbibe in our lives. The first incident is the youth who worried about their iman, who protected their iman, who went through, they were almost about to be assassinated or sentenced to death, but they were not prepared to forsake their iman. They left their homes, they left their dwellings, they resided in that cave, and Allah Ta'ala made that amazing, miraculous event take place where Allah gave them sleep. And Allah didn't let time take an effect on them, because He is Al-Khaliq, the creator, the controller, the provider. As Allah wants, things happen. Everything is makhluq, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is Al-Khaliq. So when they went through all of that, Allah gave them this miraculous sleep. And after 309 years, when they had awakened, Allah ta'ala showed them Allah ta'ala's qudra. And this is a lesson for us, how Allah ta'ala will help us, that iman is what will protect us throughout all challenges and ordeals. Among the other events mentioned in this beautiful chapter of the Quran Kareem is that of realizing that our wealth belongs to Allah. So Quran narrates the incident of the two men who are friends, and when they meet each other, the one visits the other and he tells him that this wealth that you have comes from Allah. And his friend refuses to realize this. And he says, what do you mean about talking about Akhirah, Jannah, the year after, preparing to meet Allah? There's no such thing. This world is ever living. This is what we have. This is real success. So his friend tells him, أَكَفَرْتَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَكَ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. Do you deny that being who created you from dust? ثُمَّ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ. Then Allah made you from a droplet of liquid. ثُمَّ سَوَّاكَ رَجُلًا. And Allah then fashioned you into this perfect form of a human being, of a man. He says, I will never denounce my Allah. Everything comes from Allah. So what we realize, what we learn to realize, everything is from Allah. And nothing happens without Allah. Everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is one of the very, very important lessons in this chapter. The other is also the knowledge that we acquire, that also is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a person should sacrifice and spend more and more time and journeys to learn more and more. Like we learn from Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and this event in this chapter where Musa alayhi salam, despite knowing so much, he undertook that journey to meet his junior Khadir alayhi salam. And how much of respect he showed Khadir alayhi salam, because he wanted to learn from him. So we learn that one should sacrifice to learn more and more. And then also the incident of Dhul Qarnain, where
how he used his authority and his position and his status to uplift Allah's deen and to spread the deen of Allah and to bring justice to people. So these are key qualities amongst others inculcated in this chapter that will